for coming tonight. We've got two speakers. Andy Danzig, who is a member of the task force, is going to talk about the photovoltaic installation on his home. And then we have Alex from Solar Solutions.
Sunlight Solar,
who is a contractor who installs PV arrays on homes. Good news is we've been able to sign up over 100 of our town residents for Connecticut Clean Energy Options. And what that's done is given the town a 2-kilowatt photovoltaic system. We also have signed up the town to buy 20% of its energy from renewable resources. And we have a significant percentage of our residents signing up for clean energy options. So we get another 1-kilowatt array. That's 3 kilowatts, which is not a lot, but it's a good start. So the engineers are going to come and look at 3-4 town buildings, and we'll make a determination which would be the best. Beecher Road School, the library, this building, town hall, we're not sure. But the whole point is, because you all have signed up for Connecticut Clean Energy Options, it benefits the town to the tune of about $30,000. Here is a sign-up form. Everybody who's on the task force, could you put up your hand? Sherry, Andy, and I. We encourage you to join our task force. A lot of exciting things are going on, including students at Amity High School are participating in a contest, as are kids in the intermediate schools and at the elementary schools in Orange and Bethany, a contest to make videos, write poems, essays about how they're saving energy and why that's good for the environment. We're doing housewarming parties where we will go into people's homes and show them how to implement 20 conservation actions and save $10,000 over 5 years. Invest $50, save $10,000. It's not a bad return on your investment. So we're doing a bunch of things, and we welcome you to join our committee. These sessions are being videotaped, so they will be on the internet for people to look at if you can't come. We strongly urge you to invite your neighbors to come to these sessions. We need more people in the town. And Bethany has signed up 350 people. We've only signed up 115. And Woodbridge is twice as big. What's wrong with us? And now Orange, which is bigger than Woodbridge, is just starting to get involved as well. So please take one of these sign-up sheets. This is how you sign up to buy your electricity through the grid. The wires that run to your home can deliver electrons from a nuclear power plant or a windmill, it doesn't matter. We'd like you to sign up for clean, renewable energy. Here's a paper that describes the mission of our task force, what we're doing, and here's an example of the contract that you signed with United Illuminating. So all you're really doing is substituting the source of electrons from coal plant, oil plant, or nuclear plant from wind or another. So without further ado, Andy Danzig, he's going to talk about the photovoltaic system he designed and installed on his home. Andy.
Great, thanks, John. First technological glitch, our remote control isn't working, so I'm going to have to stand on this side. I'd rather stand on this side, so just to access the computer. I think if we turn the front lights out, we'll get a better view of the slideshow. Generally, presentations start with a talk and we end with questions, but I'm a kind of backwards kind of guy, so I want to start with questions, and to make it more backwards, I'm going to ask you questions instead of you asking me questions. So first, how many people here have been to the speaker series before? Been any of the previous three speaker series? Okay, not including people who gave the talks. Okay, so a few of you. All right, so most of you haven't, which is, it's unfortunate because you missed them, but it's fortunate for me because you won't be able to measure me against what you've already heard. So that gives me a better chance because the previous presentations were phenomenal. So, I really have some big shoes to fill, but since you didn't see those shoes, I get a little break on that. Second question, how many of you are familiar with solar power and how it works and all that kind of stuff? Oh, more people, great. Okay. How many of you are interested in nuclear power. I'd rather hear about nuclear power. One. Okay. Well, I'm going to talk to you about nuclear power tonight. All right? When you think of nuclear power, what do you think of?
93 million miles.
All right, we've got the plant in the back. All right? I'm going to talk about nuclear fusion. All right? Think of nuclear power, you're thinking of uranium and fission and making plutonium and, you know, radioactive waste, all that kind of stuff. All right? That's nuclear fission. That's taking a big, heavy radioactive molecule and it splits up into smaller parts. Nuclear fusion, taking two hydrogen atoms, fusing them together, releasing a lot of energy. All right? That's what's going on up here, 93-some million miles away. Nuclear fusion. All right? And that's our sun. Big nuclear reactor. And that's what we want to tap into tonight. So, without further ado, I guess I'd introduce myself. John did already. I appreciate that. My wife and I, Lori, have been in town here for almost 6 years. We really enjoy living here. And we joined the task force, the Clean Energy Initiative Task Force, just to get involved with the community. I'm also on the CERT team, the Citizens Emergency Response Team. And by profession, I'm an environmental engineer. So I have involvement professionally with the environmental field, also on the engineering side. So anyway, we'll talk about some technical things, we'll talk about some environmental things, and hopefully we'll all learn a little something. So let's see if we can go. In terms of what we're going to talk about, review a little bit of terminology. Alex should be here shortly to talk about this in greater detail, and he'll also talk about, you know, PV and how it works. I'm going to talk about my personal experience with solar voltaics. You know, I'm not an expert by any means, but I've learned a lot just from having, been involved with it for a couple of years now. And, you know, talk about some actual results, compare that to the estimated amounts that the installer predicted and that kind of thing. A big component of working with solar power is, now that we have an array on our roof, we're a power generator. Okay, so, and we're linked to the grid, so we're involved with UI. So, UI is United Illuminating. I think, does everybody here have United Illuminating for their electricity?
CLP
and Bethany. Wow, the line's that close. All right. Well, I don't know how CLP works. I know there's been a lot of issues in the news lately, but I imagine that the issues I'm identifying here with UI will be transferable to CLP. And we'll talk a little bit about economics, since that may be of interest, and then close with some lessons learned, and we'll take it from there. Okay. Brief, basic level terminology, solar photovoltaics, producing electricity from the sun. Okay, taking that big nuclear reactor 93 million miles away, creating electricity here in Woodbridge. There's two ways to do this kind of system. You can either be off-grid, which means you have you're not connected to a utility. Whatever power you produce, whether it's by wind or solar, that power is generated and stored in batteries, and that reserve powers your house, and you're not connected to any utility. What I'm going to talk about tonight is a grid-tied system, where I'm still tied into UI, okay, so when the sun's not shining, I still get electricity. Okay, so that's the main difference there. An inverter, we'll talk about this more later, that's a machine that converts direct current electricity to alternating current, which is what we have in our all arounds from the power company. A watt is a unit of power, and 1,000 watts is a kilowatt, unit of measure that you're billed by the utility company is a kilowatt hour. So we'll see a lot of KWHs, kilowatt hours. And CCEF is the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund. And we'll hear more about them. Anybody familiar with Connecticut Clean Energy Fund? Very few people. Great. All right. First thing I want to talk about solar power is that it is accessible to every single person every day, all right? And okay, it's easy to smile, okay, oh yeah, I've seen that before. Anybody have these at home? How many? Two? Four? Come on, don't be shy, all right? Every single person can get access to solar power with this, okay? And it's, I highly encourage it. And this, if you walk away with nothing else except, wow, I'm gonna go to the hardware store, spend $4 and hang my clothes on the line, and I'll be accessing solar power, all the power to it. You've gotten everything you need to know out of this talk, all right? This is like the most, one of the most important things you can do, because it's, you don't have to get engineers involved, you don't have to design anything, okay? And the beauty of it is that it works all year round, okay? There's actually an organization called laundrylist.org where you get all kinds of information about the everything you want to know about hanging clothes on the line that you're afraid to have. It gets involved in politics and this and that, because believe it or not, there are associations and homeowners groups and this and that. There are all kinds of edicts. Even Woodbridge has a clause, okay? There's laws regulating the use of laundry clotheslines. I mean, because, my gosh, there must be something incipient thing. I don't know, maybe, you know, aliens from outer space hide behind the clothes. I don't know what the reason is, but there's all kinds of regulations that are out there. Some town, some by municipality, some by state, whatever, that limit the use of clotheslines. So this is an organization that's lobbying to the freedom of hanging your clothes. And I mentioned that, you know, you can use this all year round. And this day here was about 12 degrees above zero, all right? But you can see, nice clear blue sky. Sun shining, the clothes dry. So don't let the temperatures dissuade you from using it all year. And, you know, on days when it's cloudy or rainy, you put a drying rack in your house and dry clothes, just not using the clothes dryer. Clothes dryers, I think, use on an average 10% of the household electricity. And they're big energy hogs. So again, free access to solar power right here. Okay, we talked about going from the dream to the reality. We have a big, not a very big house, but a big roof. And, oof. I'm going to wake you up on that. And looking at that roof, kind of dreaming about, wow, all that sun beating down that roof, what can we do with it, you know? So this is kind of our journey from dream to reality. Woo! So, let's join this journey here. Right? It started like that in the beginning. Okay, so if you're considering putting solar panels on your roof or somewhere on your property, first thing you need to consider is solar exposure. And where am I going to get maximum benefit from the sun, exposure to the sun? Okay, my house, our house, is a ranch, and it's aligned almost perfectly north-south. So that big roof, the question was, well, which side is better, the east side or the west side? Which side gets more sun? So I had different people look at it, and in terms of, this is related to the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund requirements for rebates, we'll talk about that later, but you need a 75% minimum adjusted solar exposure to qualify for the rebates. So that's, you know, it's a big aspect. We talk about the economics, that's a big, it's an important part. So you want to make sure you meet that, you know? And if someone says, no, you're not going to meet it on the east side, you better go on the west side. And the other guy says, no. So definitely meet it on the west side, but you're not going to meet it on the east side. Then I knew I was in trouble because, you know, somebody's got to be wrong. So, you know, we did some simulations and here's the east side of the house. And the guy said, well, we can put some panels here this way, and oh, we can put them on this side, and this one might work better. And the other guy said, no, that way it may work better. So, you know, what do you do? Well, I went out there with a compass and measured it myself and tried to figure out the deflection, the magnetic north, the true north, and tried to figure out, you know, and it was very tight. So, you know, there's some other factors besides just, you know, where the sun is shining. You know, you want the orientation, the north-south orientation. The pitch of the roof is important because you're sliding angled towards the sun, away from the sun. Shading, you know, the more trees on one side of the house than the other. So, you know, one simulation put flat panels on the east side of the house. Looks like nice bright sunny exposure. That should work pretty well. these trees are pretty low, they don't really bother it, so let's, maybe that's a good way to do it. And then I started talking to the guys, I said, what about if we tilt them towards the south? Because the south is to the left side, okay? So we looked at putting them on and tilting them towards the south, see if that would help. And that's what we ended up doing. And as a true Democrat in the small d sense of the word, right, we went for both sides. So we tilted them towards the south and put them on both the east and the west. And the installer proposed 28 panels. And we decided to go with 30. And I'll explain, keep that just as an aside. And I'll explain why we did that later. So we finally, after many months of analysis and talking to different installers and getting different ideas, we picked an installer, decided on a style, and then it was a matter of putting money down on the table and getting the hardware on the roof. So we got the racks installed, then came the panels. I mentioned we went with 30 panels. The panels are 190 watts each. That's what they look like up close. Little individual cells, and then on a whole, all integrated into a panel. Now each panel, had five racks, six panels each. And that's what they look like on the east side. Here's from the back with the tilted mount. And for those who are interested in all the nitty-gritty of how much they weigh and how big they are, this is the statistics here for each panel. Okay, so it's not covering a huge amount of area, but you can see they're well spaced apart so that when the sun is shining, this panel won't shade the back panel. They're spaced far enough apart for that.
Andy, when you say each panel is 190 watts, that means...
That's the panel literature here, and you can look at this afterwards. There's different ways of rating the wattage of a panel, and hopefully Alex will touch on this a bit later, so I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on it. There is a thing called a maximum power, okay, a specified power, and there's actually two different systems of measuring it. Okay, the manufacturer will use one, they'll call it 190, and then there's, I think it's called an STC watt or something, which means, I'll leave it for Alex to give you the detail on that, okay? And then there's another way of measuring it, which will come out to 175 watts, right? And the CCEF, they'll take the lower number in terms of their calculations and stuff. But whatever it is, it's just a measure of output that the panel can produce, okay, maximum number. And then there's different efficiencies related. We'll touch on that. So it's a good question. We'll touch on that in a few minutes.
For reference, uh-huh. What does an average home use on one day? These are generating 190 watts, give or take, is the average.
Yeah, this system here is 190 watts times 30 panels is 5,700 watts, 5.7 kilowatt is the size of the system. So if if it was 100% efficient and the sun was shining on it, for an hour, it would be producing 5,700 watts that hour. Okay. The average usage. I'm going to get into usages in a little bit. So just hold that question and. I don't have an answer for one average per hour. I have an average per household per year, and then we can figure it out from there.
And the figure I've heard is 4 kilowatts is an average household across America. So 4 kilowatts of photovoltaic panels could provide electricity average residential
needs. The question was, what is the electric consumption in your home?
Per hour.
Yeah. It's 24 kilo. It's about 24 kilowatts a day.
24 kilowatt hours a day. Yeah, it depends on that. And what we're going to, what I'll get to in a few minutes, is talk about how you can figure things out for yourself, because the average in the country doesn't really make any difference. You want to know what you have in your house, and I'm going to show you how you can figure out what you're doing in your house. Okay, so that's really the most important number. That's the inverter converting the DC, the direct current, to alternating current. It doesn't make that much noise. But this is just in terms of the installation stuff. This is the guts of the system, all right? The panels are great, you know, out there exposing themselves to the sun and all that kind of stuff. But this is where it all comes together in terms of making it useful for you. Now, this is the nice part in terms of like being able to see what you got, what you're producing. This is the photovoltaic meter. This is recording how much power you're producing from those panels. So that's like, wow, this is the greatest, the part you want to look at every day and say, oh, what did I do today? You know, a nice sunny day today. It's like, wow, I got 25 kilowatt hours, you know, it's great, you know. So this is kind of the neat part and the success was in the basement. You don't have to climb up on the roof, you know, and you can just go down here and look at the meter and see what's happening. There's an ironic part about having a grid-tied system. When would you think you'd want to have your own access to power the most? Rhetorical question, but you can throw out an answer.
6 p.m.
When the power goes out, right? It's a storm, whatever. There's an accident, somebody's doing construction, boom, they knock a pole down, the powers go out. They're like, doesn't matter, man. I got my, you know, as long as it's during the day, right? The power goes out during the day, I got my panels on the roof, I'm going to plug in my toaster, I'm golden, right? No. All right? The system is designed with an automatic disconnect. So if the power goes out, the system gets shut off. Okay? And this is just an array of the whole thing, how it's all three components, how they're laid out. There's actually two disconnects, one on the outside, one on the inside, just as a fail-safe. And the reason for this is, if there's an outage and it's during the daytime and the linemen are out there working, because you know, if the power's out, you know, they get 4 million phone calls in a minute, hey, my power's out, I want my power back, and they're all scrambling to get the power back on. And if the linemen are out in the pole near your house fixing the wires, right, and they are under the assumption that the power is dead because of an outage, and they're up there handling these wires, some, you know, 4,000 watts are flying through their line from the solar system, these guys are going to get zapped and bad things are going to happen. Okay? So as a safety to protect the linemen, the system's designed with the solar disconnect. Okay? So it's kind of, like I said, a big irony of having the system. The time you really think you need it most, you can't have access to it. So you got to get used to it. Okay, the next major exciting component of the system is called net metering. This is where you get involved with the utility company. So there's two types of meters. I haven't seen, well, I used to have a meter like this, but I haven't seen it do this. Does anybody have the meter that just rotates and has the thing that spins around? You still have those? Do you have that too?
I have a question.
Okay.
Going back to the solar disconnect.
Yeah.
When the power is off on the grid, this shut down the power going into the grid?
It shuts down the whole system.
It shuts down the whole system. Now, is this... I'm sure there's got to be other devices that would shut down electricity from going to the grid, but not into the house.
I asked about that, and they're not allowed by code to do that.
In Connecticut, it's not allowed.
I don't know if it's Connecticut or everywhere, I don't know.
It's no different than having a generator. You can't backfeed the system
right. During
emergency conditions.
So, anyway, do you remember the meters? Does everybody have a meter like this, siphon one? You all have the LED, LCD meters now. Do you remember the meters, the old meters that used to have the dial that spun?
Yeah.
You always hear about the dial spinning backwards in the solar system. I haven't seen those dials, you know, with the solar system, but they say if you only have one meter, when you're producing power, your own power, you're sending power back to the grid, the meter spins backwards. What we have here are two meters, and the top meter measures what we're bringing in from the grid, from UI, and the bottom one is what we're sending out through the solar system. Okay, so it measures, you know, in terms of your net usage, just a simple arithmetic of in minus out. Okay, there's another disconnect out here, and just in terms of just how things are happening, the power is coming in off the arrays, all work with the channel, there's this one wire going in to the house, they go through the disconnect first, and out to the inverter, then it's converted to AC, and then it goes to the other meter that's measuring total PV production, and then the power goes, feeds whatever demand you have in the house first, okay? If it's on a bright sunny day and you're producing more power than the house is using, the excess is coming out to this meter here and going back to the grid. Yes, John?
And there's a microphone if you want to use it.
Oh, can you have, do you have trouble hearing me?
It's noisy.
I don't like it.
You don't have to use it, I just sing.
Is it like someone doesn't want to start singing, you don't want me to. Okay, if you have trouble hearing me, I'll use it, but if we're okay, then we'll keep going. Okay. So now we'll have a little primer, net metering 101. Or meter reading 101. Anybody read their power meter?
Every so often,
very good. Do you compare it to your UI bill?
No.
No?
That is the UI.
Right, but do you compare your readings to what you get on your bill?
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Excellent. You get a gold star. You get an extra brownie. If you had brownies, you get an extra one. But we don't have any brownies. All right. On that LCD meter, there are a number of displays. Okay. I highly recommend you learn how to read a meter, whether you do solar or not, just for the... So, first part is daytime. This is the key number here, total kilowatt hours. UI, I think CLP has it also, has a different rate system. Okay, what I use is called the time of use rate. Anybody familiar with the different rates? Peak rate, off peak? All right. There's a tiered structure where there's a higher cost during peak hours and a lower per kilowatt hour cost on the off-peak times. I'll tell you those times in a minute. The on-peak demand, off-peak demand, don't worry about those numbers. Those are geared for industrial customers. Program ID is just a UI thing. You don't have to worry about that. And this internal watt constant is just something that they do. You don't really need to know. The main things you need to know are 4, 5, and 7. Plus the date, days are pretty important, you want to match up, okay? So those are the main parts. When you see the meter scrolling through, it's, you know, it takes about, I don't know, 3 or 4 seconds on each item. Those are the ones you want to pay attention to. Okay? So here's the upper meter, the in meter. You can't read that. This is saying 15,734 on code 4, which is the total kilowatt hours. And this is the out meter on number 5. Okay, so you can kind of get a sense of what was happening in your house. Okay, but why is this important? I mean, if you come home from work, you know, you want to check your mail, bump a bump, you know, see if you have any messages, and of course, next on your list is you want to go out and read your meter. I mean, it's always important. I didn't realize how important this was. It took me a few months, because after we got the system, solar system, we're looking at our UI bill closely, and I'm looking at the numbers, and we have the tiered rate, the peak and off peak. Now, peak is during, at the time it changed last year, but at the time we installed the system, peak hours were from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Okay? Now, what is happening during most of those hours if it's not cloudy?
Sun is out.
Sun is out, all right? So the solar production is going to be highest during the peak hours. What UI was telling me was that I was consuming more electricity from them during peak hours than I was during off-peak hours. And I said, that doesn't make any sense. So I started reading my meter. That's what got me started on it. It took me, you know, a month or two into it to say, what's going on here? And I talked to the UI guys and I said, I think your billing is wrong. You know, something's mixed up. And I explained it to him and he's like, oh yeah, your your peak numbers for their, because they have, you know, you saw 2 meters. They're getting those results for both those meters. They're measuring what they're providing to me, and they're measuring the amount that I'm sending to them, both peak and off peak. And they said, oh yeah, you'll be producing more power. You'll be sending more power out during the peak times. And I said, well, how come on the bill the numbers are switched? And he said, oh, that's not right. That's not true. And I'm like, well, look at it. And he went through his computer, and he says, no, though, the computer's telling me, okay, this is the computer, you know, these computers talk very loud. The computer's telling me that these numbers are the peak numbers, and these are the off-peak. And I said, but the sun is telling me, okay, he's listening to the computer, I'm listening to the sun, all right? So the sun's telling me I'm producing more power when the sun's shining than when the sun's not shining. And he's like, wow, that's really interesting. So after a number of months, you know, at one point, you know, he was very kind, and he, you know, he was a good customer service guy. He was actually wasn't customer service, he was billing, all right? So he was very intent on making sure that the bill was right, you know? He wasn't going to hold fast to his position just because the computer told him. So he did what any good person would do when there's a discrepancy. He brought in the experts. And at one point, we had 3 meter engineers out of their house looking and examining our meter. I never heard of a meter engineer before, and we had 3 of them. And the net result was the meter was right and the computer was wrong. And what was happening is somehow, this is another weird thing, they used to have, I remembered, you know, not too long ago, guys would come from the utility truck and they'd walk out and they'd go to your house and they'd look at the little dial spinning around and they'd have like 5 different dials on the meter and they'd be writing down numbers with a pencil, you know, and that's how they read your meter. That's all passe. Now you've got radio signals going from that little meter you saw there up to the telephone pole, and they scurry along those power lines till they get to Kansas, all right? It's like Wizard of Oz all over again. And they go to some billing center in Kansas, and on the way, the peak meter number switched off and jumped, and they switched places with the off-peak numbers. So by the time it got to some computer in Kansas, which showed up back on this guy's desk in Connecticut, they had the number switched, which, believe it or not, was to their advantage, because the peak rates are higher than the off-peak rates, all right? So we got it figured out after a few months.
Andy, if I may, a clarification on the peak and off-peak rate of UI. UI, yep. Basically the UI bill is, the rate is has 2 components, the transmission rate,
yep.
and the generation rate.
Yep.
UI has a peak and off-peak rate in which if you use most of your electricity during the off-peak hours, they will only charge you 8 cents. But you have to sign up for that rate.
So right, you have to, something you have to, right, the rate structure, the peak, this, what's called the time of use rate, something you have to sign up for. I'm not sure what the default is, but there are different rate structures you need to look into. But I'll get into the billing part. If you think the meter is complicated, wait till we get to the bill, that's coming up. So I mentioned, at the time we started this system in 2006, the peak rates were 9 to 8. And April 1st of this year, of last year, of 07, they extended the off-peak times by 3 hours. Town of Woodbridge does not want you to be cold in this building. Now, so it's kind of a good thing because you have, you know, more hours at the cheaper rates. But they didn't reprogram the meters. So now when I read that list of items on the meter list and I have the peak and off-peak times, my numbers aren't matching up with UI's numbers because they didn't reprogram the time of when the meter's reading the peak and off-peak times. Now, why is this important? Well, you may have noticed that the rates have gone up, especially in the last couple of years. And we're going to get to rates here in a minute. The rates are really complicated. There's peak and off-peak, if you have the time of use rate, and there's summer and winter rates. Now, the summer rates have gone up since 2006, about 45%, and the winter rates have gone up about 85%. And I'll show you that graphically in a minute. Okay, before we get to the UI bill, take a break from all that for a little bit. We'll let's go back to the solar power. The, it's blue on my screen, I think it's kind of blue here. Okay, the left-hand bars, the blue bars here, is what the my installer estimated based on whatever his calculations were, how much power our 5,700 watt system would produce in each month. Okay, so we got, you know, January through December, and then they just repeat. Okay, so their numbers are constant because that's what they predicted on average. Now, obviously, 2 years is not a lot of data for comparison, but that's all we have to go with, so that's what we're going to look at. What we actually produced is the, is that maroon? And you can see that January, we definitely they overestimated, at least the last 2 years. This is last January, and this was actually last month. So we got a little better last, actually, this January number is probably skewed because that was the first month it was installed, but whatever. Some of them are pretty close, some are far apart, but it's just to let you know that, you know, you're dealing with statistics and averages and all that kind of thing. And what's important is what you actually do. So it's nice to kind of see how the reality matches up with the theory. The bar on the bottom, someone mentioned about average kilowatt hours a day. The scale is kind of too large to really to see this, but you can see in the summer month, or in, actually not even the summer months, but in the summer months, kilowatt hours a day are a lot higher than in the winter when we're not producing as much. I think the winter is averaging about 8 to 10 kilowatt hours a day of production. In the summer, it's over 20, 23 or 24. So, you know, we'll see how that matches up to what we're actually using. Okay, so why are we producing, you know, they're predicting, you know, 400 kilowatt hours a month and we're only producing 200. Why do we have those discrepancies? So, you know, what affects production? Obviously, if it's cloudy out, the sun's not shining, that affects things. Here we have a nice sunny day. You can see the panels look 90% clear, not producing anything, nada. Very frustrating, not having a nice sunny day with all those panels on the roof and you're not producing anything. What's happening, again, I'll let Alex explain the technical stuff in more detail, is that, remember I showed you that all these individual cells in here are all connected? If any of those cells are not generating, then it kind of short circuits the whole panel. All right, so you gotta get the whole panel clear before you do that. So, you know, it could be if you have leaf litter falling and stuff like that, so just things to look out for in terms of things that could affect production you may not be aware of. Someone asked a question about, you know, the panels and the, you know, the wattage and how is that determined and all that. What's most important is not just what the panel's rated for, and there's different systems in the rating I mentioned, but what the efficiencies are. Okay, because everything gets channeled down through these efficiencies. So you have panel cell conversion, the whole panel module conversion, the inverter efficiencies, and then all the, you know, you have losses through the wiring and all that kind of stuff. There's many places where you can have energy losses and efficiency losses. So in terms of, you know, not all panels are created equal and all inverters are different, configurations can be different, all those things can affect production. So, you know, just things to keep in mind. All right. So now we're going to look at how much of our own power that we used came from the sun, basically. So the maroon bars are our net production each month, okay? And the blue bars is our usage in the house, which, again, just take the difference of the UI meters, the net in, net out, plus what we're producing from the from our solar unit. You're welcome to come in. So this is just for the last 2 years, and you can see that many months here we are producing more power than we're using. Especially right here in May, June, July. Let's see, well, the first year we didn't as much. It was 1 month. We exceeded a little bit. And you can also see what the total usage is per month. Here we had a peak month usage over 1,200 kilowatt hours in a month. Our lowest was around, well, this is a skewed number here because it was when the system started. Here we had a low here over a little over 420. So, you know, obviously the goal is to incorporate other efficiencies in your usage of electricity to lower this number, right? Because even though you got 100% of your power from the sun, right? If you can reduce your usage, that's more you're sending back out into the grid, and then you have solar power available for other people. All right, that was the sum total for the last 2 years is that 73% of our household electricity has been supplied by the sun. The estimated figure based on the installer's calculations was 68%. So while we produced less power than you predicted, our percentage of our household usage was higher, probably because we made some other efficiencies in our usage. So that's just a number that we have. This isn't directly related to solar, but you know, part of the task force is talking about, you know, things you can do to reduce energy usage in the first place. And this is just a graph showing our usage for the last 5 years. And the trend is down, okay? So this is, you know, this is, the total usage incorporates in those last 2 years what we produced from the sun. So it's not related to the solar, but it's just showing how you can do things that will reduce the amount of power you're using. So it can be done, and, you know, the task force you see online, and we have materials. There's lots of things you can do, very simple things that John talked about in previous sessions, and we'll get to a greater detail, you know, through the speaker series as it goes on. There's lots of things you can do to reduce your usage. That's, you know, again, simple stuff. All right, let's talk a little bit about economics, because let's go real briefly through this. The system, the cost per watt was that. There's a rebate from the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund of $5 a watt. That's what the rate was when we got the system 2 years ago. And there was a maximum of 5,000 watts of $25,000. Okay, so the net cost after the rebate ended up being this. The installer estimates maintenance cost of $500 at about 15 years after installation. We sell what's called a renewable energy credit to a broker. This is actually a market now, renewable energy credits. And so for every kilowatt hour we generate, that's just the surplus that goes back on the grid, but just our generation, okay? They pay us 6 cents a kilowatt hour for that. So that's just cash that comes back in that we do that. Now, there are other brokers that buy it for 2 cents, 3 cents, whatever. We were able to lock in at 6 cents. You know, it's like a free market thing. So that's just one other item. And then there was, in 2006, there was a $40 billion energy tax bill, if you remember that. And, you know, $39.99 billion went to the oil companies and all that kind of stuff. Well, $2,000 went to solar, okay? So we got a $2,000 tax credit for installing the system in 2006. I mentioned earlier with the installation, the installer recommended the most efficient cost-wise, with the, you know, balancing the rebate versus the cost of the system, was 28 panels. When I found out about this $2,000 tax credit, I said, let's put that money, you know, obviously the credit doesn't come until a year later when you do your taxes. I put that money into two new panels a year in advance of even receiving that credit, okay? So that's why we had 30 panels instead of the recommended 28. Okay, talked about the metering, and that was related to the bill. So, let's just do a electric bill, course 202. And if this thing works right, it'll open up so you can read it. Look at that, magic. Okay. This gentleman here mentioned that there's a couple components to the power bill, to your electric bill, generation and transmission. That's true. You got generation charges and transmission charges, called delivery charges. Now you'll notice, it's not so simple. Within each of those components, you've got several things. You have peak, off-peak, generation, and you'll see these are listed twice. Several times during the year, you're going to see double of everything. It's not because your eyes are going bad, it may be, but most of the time it's because your billing period is in the middle of a month. And on the first of that month, you switch from summer rates to winter rates, or vice versa, or there's a rate increase, or something happened on the first of that month. So half of the month, half your billing period is on one rate, the other half is on another rate, and that doubles for peak and off-peak. So these bills can get really confusing, especially when you're trying to figure out what's my cost per kilowatt hour. Right? They're going to give you your effective generation rate. Oh, they're saying, oh, it's only 11.5 cents. Well, that's just up here. All right? And you know, you look at the bills you had from a couple years ago, it was around 4.5 cents. All right? So the bill can be take a lot to decipher, but it's worth doing it, okay, especially if they're switching your peak and off-peak numbers and they're charging you more for the higher rate, you know what I mean? This just happened to be the last month's bill, and it's showing you, I starred some things that, you know, we mentioned the rate increases. These are the items that went up. There's actually a couple items that went down. There's a combined public benefits charge which funds the CCEF credit, okay? So all of the electricity users in the state are contributing to that fund, and you're paying into it, everybody's paying into it, you use electricity. It's not a state grant or anything like that. It's coming from this fund that you're paying in your utility bills, okay? So if you tap into it, then you get the credit. So that's just one aspect. There's a number here, we talked about the Connecticut Clean, John mentioned the Connecticut Clean Energy option that encourages everybody to sign up for. This is saying here that we're getting 100% of the power that we're using from UI, that we're not producing ourselves, is coming from other renewable sources that UI is buying, from wind or hydro. Okay, it's not solar. So there's a 1.1 cent per kilowatt hour surcharge for that option. Okay, so there is a cost associated with it, but like I said, you incorporate energy efficiency measures more than compensate for that cost. But what's interesting for me is, and you'll see it more on the next slide, the way the metering is working. UI is billing me on my net usage. Okay, they're subtracting out the amount that I sent back to UI during the course of this month. So my total, we'll just keep a number, just keep an eye on this number here, 633, okay? I'll go to the next slide. Make more sense in trying to describe it. Come on. Because we keep the mice moving. Is it doing anything, John? All right.
Scroll down on the sidebar, Andy, there's another, it's part of the PDF, second page of the PDF.
No, it's not a second page, it's, I'm trying to get back to the PowerPoint. It's not letting me, I need to escape. All right.
Minimize that one.
Well, hopefully it'll, thinking. What was happening? Anyway, the I'll just go on. It's absolutely good stuff to do. The UI is billing me for these numbers up to 507 kilowatt hours. Okay, because that was the net based on, you know, I took in 633 that month and sent out some others, and the net was 503. For some reason, the Connecticut Clean Energy Options is billing me for the whole 633 and not on the net amount.
Well, they have to charge you for the way in and out, right? So they're in the business of primary electricity. So.
Yeah, okay, then you should be able to click on this. Just click on it.
Andy, it's really too small to read in when it's larger.
All right, now it opens it up. Okay, so this is just the other part of the bill. Okay, that's good.
Back to the hard part.
Which one did you go to?
Do you want to go back to
the part? No, not just yet. So this is the other part of the bill briefly where they're listing the meter readings on the peak and off-peak meters. So this is what you want to compare with, you know, with your own meter, if they're actually matching up. So, you know, here's, I'm telling you, the net is 509, and that's what they're, you know, UI is billing me at the 509, but the Connecticut Energy Options is billing me at the full 633, and not taking into account the credit. So that was just one little issue. All right, now we can, not a big deal, but just something to be aware of. What happened here? Can you be back where I was? Okay, so we talked about how rates have gone up. This is just a graph. I went through the bills for the last 2 years and looked at all those different line items and added them all up and took averages of the peaks and off peaks and all that. And came up with a rate, an average monthly rate per kilowatt hour. And here you can see, you know, in 2006, it was about 12 cents a kilowatt hour. Goes up in the summer, down again, and then really steep rise, remember last year. These numbers, yesterday they were 06, 07, I don't know how they got changed, but you can see very steep rise in 07 to now, you know, 22, 23 cents a kilowatt hour. So very big, very dramatic, in, you know, increase in rates, which is another incentive to conserve and use less. So. Okay, just to summarize a couple of issues, we mentioned that the, actually I didn't mention this. When I'm producing more power than we use in a month, on that bill where they have, you know, the per kilowatt hour charge, you know, the net cost would be zero, because I'm not, right? But instead of, from my point of view, if I'm producing more, I have a surplus, it shouldn't be a zero, it should be a credit, right? Well, what they do is, any power that I'm generating, even if I don't produce an excess amount, whatever, you know, say I send 100 kilowatt hours a month back to UI, they're giving me a credit at the off-peak rate. Even though the power on 5 out of 7 days, because the weekends are off-peak rates, right? 5 out of 7 days, those are being produced during peak times. Okay, so that's, again, that's one thing that's in the UI people say this is it's not their billing. This is from DPUC, the Department of Public Utility Control. Okay, for surplus power, it gets even worse. When I'm producing more power than I'm using, all right, and I have a super credit, right, a surplus going back to them. They're giving me a credit at 6.6 cents a kilowatt hour, all right? Whereas the average rate is 22 cents if I had to buy it from them, all right? And I mentioned the Connecticut Clean Energy Option is not taking into account the net use. So just a couple of issues there. Okay. I just calculated what the value of those discrepancies would be. It was $50 in 2006. It was at least $80 in 2007. Because I can't match up the peak and off-peak rates now, because the meters aren't matching, I don't know the exact number. That's what I just said. Okay, So, our total electric usage in 2 years we've had this system, about 9,600 kilowatt hours. 2006, we made some efficiencies, got down to about less than 9,000 kilowatt hours. 2007, our total, summing up all our UI bills for 12 months, we're ahead $197 here. Oh, good. This is okay. This includes the rebates, the credits we get, renewable energy credits. Okay, which is about $400 a year. So that's why over the whole year we have a negative amount. But it also includes the basic service charge, which is $12.5-$13 a month. Whether you use any power at all, the fact that you have a UI account, they're charging you $12.5-$13.5 a month. Okay, which is $150 a year or so. So that is included in this as well. I estimated that if we did not have the solar system and we were just buying all this power directly from UI, it would cost us this much. So our savings for those 2 years for that. Okay? Someone asked about the average figure I came across was an average home uses 19,000 kilowatt hours a year. Okay? So that's nearly double, so these costs would double for the average home. Obviously, it depends on the size of your home, you know, how many hair dryers you're plugging in at a time, and all that kind of stuff. So, all right, briefly, some lessons learned. Do your homework before and after installation. You know, you want to figure out what you need and what your exposure is, all those kind of things. Learn to read your meters, especially on billing days. And compare your readings with the UI bill. Okay, so, just want to let you think differently now when you see the sun, right? There's more information on a lot of websites, Connecticut Clean Energy, Connecticut.
We came out to Connecticut almost 4 years ago now when Connecticut started its residential net metering program. I'll talk a little bit about some of those terms as we go further along, but I'm sure Andy probably hit on a lot of those in his presentation as well. Anyway, we've done about, since coming here about 3.5 to 4 years ago, we've done about 50% of all the residential solar installations in Connecticut. Hopefully experiencing some technical difficulties. Hopefully that'll be up again soon. I'm going to work on that. Go on. Talking. Anyway, solar PV or solar photovoltaic panels turn sunlight directly into DC electricity. A rough part of the science, this is the panel is made up of these cells, which are silicon doped with boron and phosphorus. The thing to know is when you put those components together, they have differing numbers of electrons and empty spaces in the atoms, and when you put them together like that, they share electrons, with the end result being there's always an extra one looking for a place to sit down. And when the sun hits it, it'll knock one of those loose, and it literally will come out through the wires and filaments in the back of the cell, and that's the electricity that's produced. With the advent of net metering is the process by which you can sell the electricity that you produce back to the electric company. Prior to net metering, if you had a solar system, you had to, either you could use the electricity there on site, or you had to store it in some sort of a battery or something like that, and, use it at a later time. But it wasn't a very efficient means of storage, and, if you had a number of overcast days, you might run into problems with the electricity. With net metering, the grid sort of acts as your battery backup. There's no storage of the power. So during the day, when the sun's shining, they'll hit these panels, which will mount, preferably on your roof. The electricity will come down through wires to a device called an inverter, which will mount next to your, as close to your main service panel as possible. And during the day when the sun's shining, whatever you're running in the house will pull electricity from that solar array first, and anything in excess of what you're using at that time, as Andy mentioned, I'm sure, will go back out into the utility grid, and you'll receive a credit for that.
Is there such a thing as a meter that spins both ways or not?
In the older days, when they, you know, you actually had an analog meter, the basic way net metering worked is it goes back out into the grid, and your meter would spin backwards. And then, you know, at night when there's no sun, you're not producing any electricity, you pull from the grid for your electrical needs, it spins forward, and so you're only, you know, billed on whatever it is forward. Now in the day, you know, with, you know, electric meters, there are digital meters, yeah, there are a number of different kinds. Basically, it records it on there. In UI, they usually will use a large meter doubler kind of thing, where one meter records what you're buying and the other records what you're selling.
You know how CLMP does it?
CLMP has one single meter, and it flashes between screens. One screen shows what you bought for the month. One screen shows what you sold. I think, as Andy alluded to, these meters are not designed for ease of use. The CLMP, or ease of reading by the consumer, the CLMP meter, for instance, only records what you're selling. It's not cumulative, it only records what you're selling for any 1 month billing period. So these slides basically go through how it works. PV panel on your house, DC into the inverter. PV panels create DC electricity. It needs to be converted to the AC that you use in your house. If you use all that electricity on site at the time it's produced, then you don't send anything out to the grid. If you're using more in your house at the time you're producing it, you'll be charged for what you're using above, you know, what you're producing. If you're producing more than you're using during the day when the sun's shining, that goes back out into the grid, and you get a credit for it. Which then at night, when the sun isn't shining, you pull from the grid, but you don't have to pay for that extra that you produce during the day. And a few things have changed since the Danzigs put in their system. As part of the energy bill that passed this past summer, net metering is now done on an annual basis. So if in any 1 month period you produce more electricity than what you used for that entire month, previously they would pay you at the generation rate or the wholesale rate of that electricity. Now you can carry, rather than them cashing you out at that lower rate, now at the end of the month you can carry that credit over to another month in the year where you can apply it. Seasonal, solar is a seasonal thing largely. You're going to produce more electricity in the summer than you are in the winter, because there's more sun in the summer than there is in the winter. And, so if you produce more in, say, the spring or some month when you don't have the AC on.
Daylight hours, is that what you're referring to?
Correct. Solar PV uses the sun's light to create electricity, as opposed to solar thermal, for instance, which would use the sun's heat to heat up, like hot water, which you could then use for your heating. Heat is actually a degrader of electricity, so solar PV panels will actually do better in slightly cooler climates. What we see for a lot of our customers is, there's a lot more sun in the summertime, you'll produce a lot more electricity, but most people's usage habits, they may have AC turned on in the summer, so, you know, they'll still be using a lot more electricity than what they're producing in the summer. We find that during the springtime, where the sun is sort of getting high in the sky, there's a lot of sun, but there's no AC on, it's still relatively cool out, that's when you know, you'll run into a situation where you're producing more from your system than what you're using at that time. But roughly, we want to average out across the year a system that'll cover all or a portion of your electric bill, whatever the need is. And I should mention in Connecticut, it's considered that the average between summer and winter, and taking into account historic weather conditions, is 4 sunlight hours a day. So if you have a 5-kilowatt system or a 5,000-watt system, you should predict that you'll be producing about 20 kilowatt hours a day, which is you get your bill in kilowatt hours. So that may help you to decipher some of that. Let's see here. The rebate structure in Connecticut has also changed a little bit over the few years that the program's been around. A solar system is largely, there are three main factors that affect how much electricity you produce. An optimal system would be faced 180 degrees true south. That's taking into account this declination of your compass because we're further away from the equator. So an optimal system would be 180 degrees true south with a 36 degree pitch and absolutely no shading. That system is going to produce more electricity than any variation on that scenario. And the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund has now developed a formula by which they will rebate a system that's optimally situated more heavily than a system that, you know, is not optimally.
So they want to have like a sliding scale, what you're saying?
They have a rebate that is derated based on those three site-specific factors. So I would, if you were interested in buying a system, I was going to give you a quote. I would come out to your house. I'd go up on your roof. I have a tool that'll help me determine the percentage of shade on your roof throughout the year. You know, I'd take the exact azimuth, the exact pitch of the roof. I would put those numbers into their formula, and then they would calculate a rebate based on that. Assuming you have a pretty good site, which is probably within 20 degrees of, you know, true south, you know, within 10 or 15 degrees of the optimal pitch, and very limited to no shading, you know, all things being equal, the rebate will probably cover still around 50% of the total cost.
Does it ever cover any more than 50%?
Yeah, I mean, if you have everything completely, I mean, for us in our pricing, you know, there are some things that are more difficult for us, like, you know, if your house is three stories and it's got like this 45 degree sloped roof, you know, and it's gonna, you know, we're gonna have to, you know, build scaffolding and have a wall and other stuff that's, you know, more expensive for us to do. So that would, you know, make it more difficult. You know, if it's a one story ranch and it's facing true south, and, you know, that would be a relatively easy job. So frequently, I guess I should go through the whole rebate scheme. The way the entire you occasionally you'll get up to, you know, a system that'll cover 55% or more of the total cost. Frequently it's around 50% or perhaps a little bit lower if you have a questionable site. As Andy alluded to, by far shading is the most heavily weighted factor by the Clean Energy Fund and probably the most serious limiting factor in the production of the panels. It's hard to see on this panel. This is a SunPower panel. This is actually a model. A regular size panel would be about 5 feet by 2.5 feet. But if you can see, there are little cells in here. They have a black backing, so this is one of the panels that we're carrying now. It's probably is the nicest look of most solar panels on the market.
Is there a glass that's actually on it when it's exposed to the weather, or is that it?
This is glass.
There is glass on it. Right,
yeah.
Now.
Yeah. But all these cells are connected in series, suffice it to say. So sun hits this, electricity, you know, knocks these electrons loose, they come down and hit the next cell in series, which hits the next cell in series, and so you get this sort of snowball effect of it building on itself, and all the electricity from this panel hits the next panel. If you cover up one of these cells with shade, it requires that much more for the electricity to push through that spot, so it reduces the output of not just that one cell, but all the cells behind it and all the panels behind that. Most panels nowadays are equipped with bypass diodes like this one is. So if a shade covers up a corner of the panel, for instance, it would knock out a third of the cells in the panel, but the other two-thirds and the rest of the string would continue to operate at maximum efficiency. The San, and you know, I could talk to people after about the differences in panels. The Sanyo panel, for instance, is a hybrid of two different technologies, which reacts better to shade than some other panels. But
do you find that a lot of your customers need to go on their roofs often to either clear off snow or clean off leaves or that sort of thing, or is it because of the pitch?
Most customers don't. I don't think go up on there. We don't really, I'm not sure exactly what the Danzig's experience has been, but most anecdotal evidence we've heard is that, you know, over the course of a day or two, most snow and ice will clear from the panels. You know, usually they're all black, they're facing south, they're on the roof. There's also some, there is some rise in temperature if you cover up one of the cells. The electricity, you know, has to push through there. This will sort of heat up a couple of degrees, which may be sort of an internal defroster. There's some evidence that even when they're covered, they'll still produce some electricity, however, you know, pretty
minimal. When you see these panels ganged really closely together on a roof, and let's say you have a failure in some area, do you actually walk on these panels to get to it, or does it all have to be disassembled?
What we've done in the past is I've seen installers sort of lay down and distribute their weight and go across them to get into the middle of an array, but you know, it's whatever makes sense at the time. You can walk on them. I've seen people walk on them, but I wouldn't, I don't think we would, you know, recommend walking on them. You could break the glass if you put that much weight. In terms of something being thrown at it, I mean, I don't know, they're tested with a steel ball in a laboratory at some accelerated velocity, so they're pretty sturdy.
You think there'll be a technological breakthrough that will get to higher efficiencies in the next, within the next 3 to 5 years?
For the most part, I don't think, I'm not aware of any breakthrough really in the basic physics that's going to guard the higher efficiency. The sun power panel is slightly more efficient than the other panels on the market. I believe it has a 22% cell efficiency. The overall efficiency of the panel is 18-something percent efficient, and they've gained that efficiency in a few ways, you know, basically by tweaking things. On a more traditional panel, including the Sanyo panel, all the wires and filaments that collect the electricity are on the front of the panel. Sun power has placed those connections on the back of the panel, so basically you're getting more area, you know, to be affected by the sun for the same amount of physical space. They've positively grounded them instead of negatively grounding them, and they found that that allows them to eke out, you know, a little bit extra efficiency. They're doubly reflective. They use a special anti-reflective glass. So I think to a large degree in the industry, there's not much thought to a real breakthrough in efficiency like that. A lot of the research that's been done into basically increasing the efficiency is in the form of concentrators, which, you know, either you're using a mirror so to amplify the amount of sunlight, or you're using some sort of a lens to focus the sunlight more directly onto a part of the cell. Both of those have issues, one with heat, because if you're focusing, you know, the sun like that, you're going to get a high heat. in terms of trackers, for the most part, for a lens to work, it has to track the sun very precisely, which is difficult to do and expensive, and usually requires some mechanical parts which can wear out and need to be replaced. For our, the way we sort of look at it is, a lot of electricity is a lot of electricity. It's going to be the same today as it is in 20 years. So the real question is, what are you paying for that watt of electricity? When they talk about gaining in efficiency, you're really talking about getting more production for a smaller amount of physical space, but still the question of how much you're paying for the watt is there. In Connecticut, where we have one of the best rebates for solar in the country that can cover up to 50%, and then you can take advantage of the $2,000 federal tax credit, which is still good till the end of 2008, you can get a pretty good price per watt. So, I think it makes sense to do it now. I mean, by the time, panels reach the efficiency level where, the price comes down to where the economics make sense on their own, then, there won't be a rebate. So. Some of the new panels that have been in the news lately, rather than trying to gain an efficiency, what they've been doing is trying to find something that's cheaper to produce and thereby bring the cost down. But you should bear in mind when you see these, when you see things in the news and they're saying like, oh, it's, a dollar a watt or whatever, you possibly need, 100 times more area to put that up than what you would use with a crystalline panel.
What's the life expectancy of a panel?
These panels are have a 25-year power warranty, which says they'll still be producing at least 80% of their power in year 25. So panels do degrade a little bit over time. You're losing, a little less than 1%. A year. However, in terms of the economics of the system, I guess I'll talk a little bit about that. Maybe I should just go through the rebate. The current rebate in its current incarnation is $5.91 a derated watt up to 5 kW, and then $4.30 a derated watt up to 10 kW. So what does that mean? That means that we're going to take the nameplate rating of your system, say 24, 200, 15 watt modules or something, 5,000 watts, and then they're going to the Clean Energy Fund based on will determine a percentage that you're going to lose based on those three site-specific factors: the orientation, the shading, and the pitch of the roof, or the pitch of the area where you're putting it. And they have a formula for doing that. So then they subtract that off. They subtract off some other losses for the efficiency of the inverter, the PTC wattage of the panels. Anyway, the number you're left with, they multiply that times $5.91, and that gives you your rebate up to 5,000 watts. Due to a request from a lot of people, originally the program was capped at 5,000 watts, and it was $5 a watt with a $25,000 cap. Now you can go above 5,000 watts and still get a rebate. However, you're being rebated at a reduced rate, the $4.30 a watt. So essentially, the more panels you put in above 5 kW, the less percentage of the total cost the rebate covers.
Why is 5 kW the magic number here, though? If you put in a 6,000 watt system, you're sacrificing a tremendous rebate, or a tremendous amount of rebate.
There are probably a few reasons. A lot of them political. I mean, I think for one thing, they wanted to stretch the money out to reach as many homes as possible, so not just a few people eat up all the all the money. It's probably a large consideration. Obviously, with the economics of if you produce more than you use annually over a one-year period. I don't know if I mentioned that before. Then you're only getting that electricity at the wholesale rate, so it doesn't pay to size a system bigger than what you use. Maybe based on an average home statistic.
I need a verification on the rebate. The rebate goes to the homeowner directly, or it goes to the installer?
The rebate is paid directly to the installer. So you would only ever be responsible for your portion of the install cost. Connecticut has paid a lot of attention to regulating the industry, partially due to the black mark the solar industry got in the 70s and 80s, where there was little regulation. So the rebate is actually withheld from us until after the system is installed, turned on, and producing electricity. So frequently the customer portion will only really cover the cost of materials. So at any rate, what does all this really mean? Basically, up to 5 kW, pretty good site, the rebate's going to cover about 50% of the cost. From 5 to 10 kW, it'll start to go down. At 10 kW, the rebate is probably going to cover, somewhere between 45 to 48% of the cost, all else being equal. So the general installation.
I have a question. Is that single family residence, or what if a condominium complex wanted to put solar panels on it?
There are a few ways to handle multifamily dwellings, and some multifamily dwellings might be eligible for the commercial federal tax credit, which is much more attractive than the residential tax credit that's capped at $2,000. But in our experience, after looking at a number of condominiums, it's sort of hard, because generally you need to get everybody in the in the condo, in the complex, to agree.
And what if you did?
Which would be difficult. There are a number of ways you can do it. If it was installed on a common area and everybody paid in, then say you could put up one big array, and then you could split off, 10 panels will feed this house,
But how would the rebate? They would give you the rebate?
It might bring up some issues. It would really depend on how it's structured. If the association was buying it, probably, or alternatively, if individuals were buying it.
Okay.
I mean, certainly if you have a unit and you opt to put them up and everybody agrees that it's okay, basically we can put however many panels on your roof. If you have it also would depend on the type of metering you have. If you have an individual separate meter, then, we would feed your meter and that would be your solar system. And, the rebate would be paid to us and you'd be responsible for your portion just like any other solar installation. So the basic process that we go through, if you decided you wanted to put up a solar system, we would go to the town, pull a permit, do all the schematics and the layout for the system, install, take you through a walkthrough, and then provide you with a final book, which would include all the schematics, all the warranties related to the system, as well as a contract for a company that could buy your renewable energy credits, probably the Massachusetts Energy Consumers Alliance, which is what I believe the Danzigs are using. And you'd be free to look for another company to buy your racks. Then we'd have to go through three basic inspections. The building and electrical inspection from the town, which is usually pretty quick, within a week. The utility witness test, where that's largely a test for them to make sure that the inverter is operating properly. Should be understood that if the grid, you're tied to the grid, and if the grid goes down, your solar system will also go down and turn off. The simple reason being that if, there needs to be some work done on the lines and linemen are up there working, they don't want you feeding electricity back into the grid to create an electrical shock hazard. So the utility comes out and does that test, at which time it can turn it on. And then subsequently, the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund will come out and do their independent inspection, which is really a more thorough inspection conducted by an expert in solar electricity. And they'll really look at everything. They'll check all the connections, go up on the roof, and check everything. And then that's about it. You know, we think there are a number of good reasons for going forward with solar. One issue to bring up is that, you know, we say real estate's at a premium in solar, and one thing that limits the amount of solar PV you can put up is the amount of, you know, available roof space you have. There are other ground mounting options and stuff like that, but they're usually expensive because, and though, if you use your roof, the house provides the structure. If you have to build the structure to support the panels, it's a largely additional expense. Global warming, solar PV reduces carbon emissions and will certainly help with that. Reduces pollution. Solar energy is good for the state of Connecticut. Every $1 million worth of sales creates 10 new jobs. Keeps your electric bill money. Rather than paying the electric company, you know, would pay the installers or whomever to come out, which keeps your money, you know, invested in your community rather than going back to the electric company. The other problem, which is especially pertinent in southwestern Connecticut, is there's a lot of energy congestion during peak times, and that's part of the reason rates are higher during peak times when there's stress on the grid. Solar PV is what they call a peak shaver. Basically, you're producing electricity, which is going back out into the grid for other ratepayers to use during the peak times when there's a lack of electricity going through the lines. So one solution to, you know, the country's energy problems, and particularly, you know, more personally to energy problems in southwestern Connecticut, is you know, the more PV you produce, you know, the less generation using coal or oil or whatever has to be, you know, put up to, you know, address people's electrical needs. If every house or, you know, more houses put on solar PV, there would be less need for, you know, other forms of generation. I think one thing to hit on is, Andy had mentioned, in year 15, we assume a maintenance charge of $500. The solar panels should, you know, act seamlessly from the time the system is turned on going forward. However, that $500 charge, the inverter device that converts the DC to AC, that's a mechanical device. It has components, you know, electricity is running through it. So, you know, at a certain point, some of those components will wear out and need to be replaced, and most inverters seem around year 15 to need some of the component parts replaced. So I didn't have too much of a presentation, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
How are the panels, how are the racks installed or attached to the roof?
I usually break the racking into two different parts. There's the feet that affix, you know, the panels and the racking to the roof, and then there's the rails that the panels are attached to. The two different, let's see if I have some better pictures. In this instance, they're two basically, in one type you'd have an L-shaped metal bracket like this, and you'd put about a 3.5-inch lag screw directly into the rafter. You know, we would drill a hole out first, fill it up with caulk, and put that screw directly into the rafter, caulk all around it. The L-foot would be attached to a metal rail, and the panel would be attached to that rail. And that's our standard installation. That's the cheapest, the easiest for us to do. We have another option, which is a little more expensive. Essentially, instead of the L-shaped footing, you've got a rectangular piece of metal, if you can imagine. It's two lag screws into the rafter. That provides a little extra hold down strength. However, both meet with Connecticut wind loading requirements. A metal cylinder would screw onto that metal plate. We would then cut away the shingle and place a roof boot under the shingle and over the metal cylinder. So, you know, flashing it like a flashing that you'd see on a vent pipe or something coming out of your roof. That covers up all the penetrations, so it's basically extra leak protection. An L-shaped bracket would attach to the cylinder, which would be attached to the rail. So it's a couple inches extra up off the roof. It's generally considered if you're a couple inches above the roof, you'll get more airflow, which you know, is a little more efficient because it keeps the panels cooler. In the Danzig's instance, we tilt mounted the panels to face them more towards the south. As I mentioned, basically having the optimal orientation is very important in you know, optimizing your production. You want to get the full range of the sun across the day. The more east or west you are, you know, in the extreme, if you were completely facing west, for instance, you wouldn't really be getting any direct sun in the morning. And in order for the photovoltaic effect to work, you really need direct sun. So you'd effectively be cutting, you know, half the day out of your solar, you know, production. So one option on an eastern-western roof is that you can tilt the panels towards the south to get optimal production.
What's the wiring look like? You see these pictures, you don't see any wires whatsoever. You know they're all hanging together, so what happens with that?
The wires are attached, I mean, basically you have two wires coming out of the back of the panel junction box, you know, a positive and a negative. We have actually special clips, so we clip these around here, and this would be connected to the next one in series. You know, they're series strings, and then they're panels are, the strings are put together in parallel to build amps, to build volts this way. So when you get to the end of the string and you want to go whip it to the next one in series, you would attach a wire on here. We, you know, have a tool to make them at the site.
So like jumpers.
So we make them to the, yeah, to the same, you know, to the right length and tie it either to the, with zip ties to the bottom of the rail or, you know.
So how many wires actually go to this inverter? Just two at the end of the process?
Well, we would probably put a combiner box either under the array attached to the rail, or alternatively, in some instances, if we don't have the room to do that because they've chosen just the L-foot, we can, you know, drill a hole into the roof into the attic, you know, cut away the shingle, flash it, use an LB joint, and we put a combiner box there. What is the combiner box? We take the wires from all the strings from the roof, combine, fuse them and combine them into one wire. One single number six copper grounding wire goes through all of the components, and so we're really only pulling two wires down off the roof.
To the inverter?
To the inverter.
That inverter mounts inside or outside?
All the inverters we use, I think all inverters that are UL listed to be installed in Connecticut are rated to be mounted outdoors. We generally like to keep them inside. I mean, why expose them to the elements if you don't have to? Plus, sort of the aesthetics. Most people don't really want an inverter, you know, mounted on the outside wall of their house, but we could do either way. You know, in some instances where someone's had a finished basement and their, you know, main service panel's kind of in there, you know, they don't want an inverter in there. We'll mount them outside if it makes sense. You know, it's really up to the customer. Yes.
I assume there have been studies comparing heat exchanger or geothermal with solar. And how do they stack up if they have had those studies?
Well, geothermal and solar thermal, you know, it's largely a different part of the energy efficiency. Most of those deal with heating or cooling the house, where, you know, solar is really the electrical side of it. Both are very good money-saving options, and, you know, we'd certainly We're specialized in solar PV in Connecticut, but would certainly advocate using either one of those. Solar thermal, as may have been discussed in previous sessions, basically you're using the sun's light to heat up water or heat up a some sort of antifreeze solution that's then put through a heat exchanger and transferred to the water. And you can use that either for your domestic hot water needs when you take a shower or you're cooking or whatever. Or alternatively, in some instances, you could use it to heat your house. I'm not an expert in that area. I think for the heating, it's expensive and sometimes requires retrofitting. We've done a lot of work in homes with geothermal. Geothermal will use a pump to circulate water into the ground to get it to either a, if you go a certain depth into the ground, you'll get a constant 50 degrees or 52 degrees or something. So in the winter, you only have to heat it up, however much more to get it to, 70 degrees or whatever, 75 degrees or whatever you want it at. And by the same token, in the summertime, you can use it to cool air down and use it for cooling.
Just so you know, I don't have the schedule, but check your speaker series schedule. There is some later on in the series a talk on geothermal. So just
I think it's in August or September.
At the end of the summer, we'll have a geothermal presentation.
Okay.
What happens if in 8 years you need a new roof?
Yeah, the Connecticut Clean Energy Fund, in order to qualify for the rebate, they require that you have at least 15 years of life left on your roof. Certainly the portion of the roof that's under the panels will be largely, protected from UV rays, which are, really what destroys roofs, and also protected from the elements. But the short answer is if your roof needs to be replaced, basically you need to take the panels down. You probably will not need to take down the racking. So we've had occasion to take systems down and put them back up for other reasons. And it's about a day's labor for us to do so.
In that picture, are they all butted close together? So the
That's the second part of the racking question, the rails. And there are two different types of rails. Wish I had my model with me, but basically in one type you'd have a metal rail that's the industrial gray. It would be attached to the L-foot or to the L-foot that's attached to the stand. The panels you'd have two rails per panel. The panels would sit on top of that rail and they'd be held down to it with clips. In this picture, this is the other type of racking system where you have one rail at the bottom that's sort of like this. It's like a channel. Panel sits in here and then it's held down with a cap strip, so they're all butted up against each other. They're in this channel.
But water's going in between. Rain can get in between the panels.
Certainly rain's going to get under the panels. It's open at the top and it's open at the bottom for airflow. I'm not aware that of any, there is airflow through there, so there aren't any occasions for rot or anything of that nature.
In that picture, are they raised up?
They're a little off the roof. Okay. They're a couple of inches off the actual roof. So.
I have a question on the same line of question that Elaine was.
Sure.
Have you found yourself doing a structural analysis of the roof when you put it all this way on top of the houses?
Yeah, we need to, first of all, we pull a building permit in order to put the system up, and we need to meet with all applicable Connecticut law. To give you some ideas, the distributed dead load of these panels is about 2.7 pounds per square foot, which is basically comparable to an additional layer of shingles. In Connecticut, generally speaking, you're allowed two layers of shingles on your roof. So if you have a single layer of shingles, there should not be any problem with putting the solar system on the roof. That being said, there are exceptions to that, and it's the type of rafters you have, the engineering of the roof, you know, the span, depth, you know. There are certain considerations in there. You know, we usually pull with the building permit at the time. We do schematics that calculate the dead load and point load, present that to the town at the time we pull the permit, and they sign off on it. If you have two layers of shingles on your roof, depending on what the engineer in the town decides, you know, we'll do the engineering, but we'll present it to the town. It may be questionable whether or not you know they will agree to let you put it up.
So the hardware calculated in your pounds per square foot of dead load?
Yeah, that's the hardware plus the panels. Each panel is about 33 pounds. They're 13.4 square feet.
I know this question will be kind of hard to answer depending on the homeowner's electricity use and how many panels they put up, but typically is there sort of a point where it's sort of break even and with the upfront costs to start?
Yeah, I mean, I can give you some ideas on pricing. A 5-kilowatt system, you know, depending on the specifics of, you know, assuming you have a fairly good site, it's probably going to run you between $42,000 and $46,000
before the rebate.
Yeah, before the rebate. The rebate would cover approximately half of that. You'd be eligible for the $2,000 federal tax credit. So, you know, you're going to be looking at, you know, $19,000 to $23,000 for a 5-kilowatt system. What will a 5-kilowatt system do for you? With UI, I would say a we're probably going to knock an average, assuming you have a good site, you're going to knock an average of $120 to $130 a month off of your electric bill. If you assume about a 5% a year increase in electrical rates, then you'd be looking at a simple payback, you know, probably between 9 to 12 years.
And understandably, that's just the cost. There's also a lot of other factors,
yeah.
Environmental, you know, other good things.
I mean, certainly if electric rates go up, you know, less than 5% a year, then, you know, it would be pushed out about a year at 3%. If they go up more than 5% a year, then, you know, you'd be doing better.
Well, if the electric companies start losing like 50% of their business, they'll be raising hell out of their rates, what do you think?
Well, as Andy alluded to, they need to go through the DPUC for any rate increase.
You're gonna do that like cake.
Yeah. One part of the new elect energy bill that was passed over the summer that may be a little different is you're no longer assessed, you cannot be assessed any additional property tax for putting solar on your house in Connecticut. Yeah, it's statewide now. Yeah, previously certain jurisdictions.
Do you know of any upcoming possible legislation that might make it even more attractive?
We would encourage everyone to contact their state, the federal legislators, Joe Lieberman, whoever you have around here. Basically, the federal, at the end of 2008, the federal tax credit is supposed to expire. There have been several bills which have been brought forth that would extend the federal tax credit. It's of a special importance for commercial because the tax credit for commercial is far better than for residential. However, it would have raised the bill that was on the table would have raised the residential cap from $2,000 to $4,000. It's important that we get that passed, preferably by the end of the year, so it's still, actually a version of it was just voted down, I think, last week, so I could give you more information. So I guess if there are no further questions.
Thank you very much, Alex. Everybody here, please come next month. There is a schedule on the table up there. We're going to be talking about photovoltaics installed in third world countries, Bhutan, other places. We'll continue this discussion on photovoltaics. Please have your neighbors sign up for Connecticut Clean Energy Options, and we have forms out there for you if you haven't already. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
You have a card?
Yeah.